طيب، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. Dear all, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. All praises belong to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, especially for allowing us to complete session one. And in session one, we discussed the meaning of fiqh from both a linguistic and technical avenue. And we said that, or we actually broke down the technical definition of fiqh word by word and explained the relevance of each word as it existed in that particular definition. And we bore witness to the relevance of those words in that definition and highlight many a time that these definitions are important so that we actually know everything that is inclusive and understand everything which is exclusive. So that's important because we got to know what we're dealing with. And remember, we said knowledge is having an understanding, right? So now you have an understanding of what fiqh is, which is tasawwur. And we discussed the rulings of studying fiqh. So now it's tasdiq, right? You understand what fiqh is. You know exactly what the ulama of fiqh are talking about when they say fiqh. العلم بالأحكام الشرعية العملية المستنبطة من أدلتها التفصيلية. Right? And you understand the Islamic ruling regarding that which I just said, or the study of that which I just said, which means now you have ilm. Alhamdulillah, you all are certified. You are certified knowers of what fiqh is. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increase your knowledge. For this particular session, I want to jump into what is commonly known as the stages of fiqh. The stages of fiqh. So when the ulama talk about stages of fiqh, they are actually referring to fiqh and its development and how it flowered and the phases that it went through in its flowering. Now, some of the scholars in the books of Tariq al-Fiqh, the books that deal with the history of fiqh, they cite six stages. And some cite seven, right? The majority cite six. And some cite seven. For our sitting, we're not going to delve into all of these stages. We're only going to delve into the development of fiqh up to the time of the presence of the madhahib of fiqh, right? Because that's what that is the one of the objectives of our sitting, to understand how the madhahib came about. And as I said, that we've only managed to put together, well, if we have time, we'll go through the Hanbali and Shafi'i madhab, but I don't see us or foresee us having that time. And inshallah, what we will take will be beneficial for the time that we sit together. But inshallah, we will have a part two and part three. And in part two and part three, what we will do is deal with the other levels of fiqh's development, as well as take the other two madhahib. So very briefly, I'm going to share with you the titles of the stages that we will take. So stage one is known as foundation. Stage one is known as foundation. So stage one of fiqh's development, the ulama have called the foundational stage. What does the foundational stage comprise of? Well, it comprises of the era of our beloved Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, from the time when he became a prophet until the year 11 after Hijrah, until his death sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the first stage of fiqh's development is known as the foundational stage, and this stage encompasses the life of Muhammad ibn Abdullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, from the time when he became a prophet to the time when he passed away, which was in the 11th year after Hijrah. Stage two is called the establishment stage. The establishment stage. And the establishment stage comprises of the era of the Khulafa al-Rashidun, from the death of our beloved Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam until the year 40 after Hijrah. Until the 40th year after Hijrah. And this stage is known as the establishment stage, from the death of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam until the year 40 after Hijrah. So that was the era of the rightly guided Khulafa. Then we have stage three. And stage three has been named the building stage. It has been termed the building stage. And the building stage, we can say, began from the founding of the Umayyad dynasty in the year 40 after Hijrah until the year 132. Until the year 132 after Hijrah. So it started in the year 40 after Hijrah. And we can say ended in the year 142 after Hijrah. So it started with the advent of the Umayyad dynasty. Then we have stage four. Then we have stage four. Stage four is the flowering phase. The flowering phase And this phase began with the rise of the Abbasid Empire in the middle of the 8th century, not the Islamic century, but the which century? The CE, the Gregorian century. Well done. So the 8th century, a Gregorian century, and it lasted to the beginning of its decline, which was around the 10th century. We're talking about the Gregorian century. So it lasted from the 8th to the 10th. So this is stage 4. Stage 4 came about with the rise of the Abbasid dynasty and lasted till around the 10th century. Then we have stage 5. And stage 5 is considered the consolidation phase. The consolidation phase. So very quickly, we had the foundation, then the establishment of fiqh, then fiqh flowering and being built, and then it really flowering, and then the consolidation phase, which is stage 5. And the consolidation of fiqh happened with the decline of the Abbasid dynasty from about 350 years after Hijrah, which was around 950 or in the 10th century Gregorian, to the murder of the last Abbasid Khalif at the hands of the Mongols in the middle of the 13th century. So that's called the consolidation phase of fiqh. So once again, that phase began with the decline of the Abbasid dynasty, which was around 950 CE, right? Maybe 960 CE. And it lasted to the murder of the last Abbasid Khalif at the hands of the Mongols. And that was in the middle of the 13th century CE. Is that clear? Then we have stage 6. Stage 6. And this is known as the stagnation phase and decline of fiqh's development. So it sort of reached a peak. And then in stage 6, we saw fiqh taking a dive. And this was from the loss of Baghdad in the year 656 after Hijrah, which was around 1250 or 1260 CE to the middle of the 19th century. To the middle of the 19th century CE. So fiqh sort of took a dive from the 13th century CE until the 19th century CE. Right? Is known as stagnation. And inshallah, when we sit for phase 2 and phase 3, I got to keep you guys intrigued, right? So you do come back when I come back. We will delve into the details of why it was called stagnation and decline and why it was called consolidation and why it was called flowering and so on and so forth. We will discuss that in greater detail. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us or preserve our life in His obedience. Inshallah, we will meet together. Allah won't take us away before we meet together and cover what we need to cover, inshallah. Ameen. So basic fiqh started taking a decline in terms of its development, and this happened in the 13th century CE up to the 19th century. So from the loss of Baghdad, for the Hijri writers, 656 after Hijrah. It began declining at 656, so in the 7th century after Hijrah. Then some of the ulama added a stage 7, and they say stage 7 is called fiqh as we have it today, or the revival of fiqh. Okay, that's what they say. So inshallah, we will discuss around the first three stages of fiqh and its development for our particular sitting together. Now, stage 1, which is fiqh at the time of our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So put that as a heading, because now we are delving into a little bit more detail regarding stage 1. Fiqh at the time of our beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. As we said, it was from the beginning of revelation until the 11th year after Hijrah, which we can say in Gregorian 609 up to 632 CE. During this phase, the sources of the Sharia were the Quran and the Sunnah. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was present. When people had questions, they would ask and the revelation would come and our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would answer. And the revelation might have been in the form of Al-Quran, or it might have been in the form of inspiration to our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which we know is the Sunnah. Because nothing that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said with regards to deen, with regards to religion. It's important we understand this, because sometimes the Orientalists try and confuse us. Because they say the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam once advised the farmers to do something, and when they followed his advice, the dates became spoilt. So they say, what kind of revelation was that? He wasn't receiving revelation. That had nothing to do with religion. That's why he told them, أَنْتُمْ أَعْلَمُ بِإِمُورِ دُنْيَاكُمْ. When they came to him and said, what have our plants have become spoiled? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, do what you know is best, because you are more knowledgeable of the field that you are in. He was merely offering what we would say today, our sixpence. Right? He wasn't telling them anything about religion. So he was a human being like yourself and myself, and he could make mistakes. But in religion, He could never make mistakes because he was protected by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So nothing that he said with regards to religion was from himself. Everything was wahi from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala testifies to this particular point when he said, Jalla jalalu wa ma yantiqu anil hawa in huwa illa wahyu yuha. That nothing that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said was from himself, was from his desires, and was from his thoughts. But indeed, it was wahi. It was nothing but revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So revelation can be wahi, and revelation can be ilham and inspiration. And it is not far that Jibreel alayhi salam would teach the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in a form that was not considered the Quran. He visited the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam once as in the form of a human being to teach us the five pillars of Islam and the six pillars of Iman and some of the signs of Qiyamah. And he sat by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and asked him about these pillars, right? And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam answered. And at the end, what did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam say? He came to teach you your religion. But was that Quran? No. Right? So basically, when a situation arose or they asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam about something, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala educated him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala educated him. So this was beautiful. This was beautiful. And we know in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala time and time again says, وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنْ وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنْ وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الْخَمْرِ وَالْمَيْسِرِ وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الْيَتَامَ وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ مَاذَا يُنْفِقُونَ. Right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, they ask you concerning the orphans. They ask you concerning what from their wealth should they spend. They ask you concerning about gambling and alcohol. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells him, قُلْ. He tells his Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, tell them such and such. Tell them such and such. Right? وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الْخَمْرِ وَالْمَيْسِرِ قُلْ فِيهِمَا إِثْمٌ كَبِيرٌ وَمَنَافِعُ لِلنَّاسِ. Tell them that in it there's a great sin. And in it is benefit for mankind. This was Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's revelation before alcohol became totally forbidden. Right? And that's another science that we need to study, the gradual revelation of the Sharia. How Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala nurtured the ummah. That the first revelations dealt with aqidah. He didn't come and say, leave riba and leave alcohol and so on and so forth. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala built iman in the people. And when the iman was shining through and they were people of sami'na wa ata'na, we have heard and we have obeyed. Thus Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed laws that fixed their situation. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did it gradually to bring them in nice and easy, for our sharia takes pride that it's built upon the concept of raf'ul haraj. The sharia is built upon the concept of alleviating difficulty. And let us ask ourselves how we have become built upon the concept of making things difficult in society, in our homes, with our schools, with our... So we should take guidance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in how He nurtured us. So this was fiqh at the time of our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's messenger was the sole authorized interpreter and practical guide, how he explained something that was the reference. If he said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala means by this particular point, that was the reference. And that was correct. So for example, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed an ayah about oppression, they said, and which one of us is free from oppressing others? That means we have no choice. Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam explained to them that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala means by oppression here, kufr. He means by it kufr, which is disbelief. Thus they took a direct lesson from Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam regarding the meaning of dhulm in that particular ayah, and that was the reference for it. Right? People understood this is the meaning, and there's no doubt regarding that particular meaning. During this phase, as I said to you, revelation was gradual. And on the spot as per need. Nobody was sitting around and saying, what if, what if, what if, what if. That came later, right? People lived their lives, and when situations arose, they asked as per need. So this was one of the important points regarding this particular phase. And the end of legislation with regards to this particular phase happened with the death of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Now, did ijtihad, this is the question that needs to be asked. Did ijtihad, do we know what ijtihad is? Personal reasoning, where you apply yourself and you research and it takes from you energy. That's why it's called ijtihad. You apply. Badhl al-juhd, as the ulama of usul al-fiqh say, that a person strives and utilizes his abilities to deduce a ruling in the Sharia. Did this exist at the time of Muhammad ibn Abdullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Did this exist at the time of Muhammad ibn Abdullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Was there cases where there was ijtihad? Well, there is a discussion in the books of Usulul Fiqh, and that discussion falls under the category, did our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam observe ijtihad? Some of the ulama say yes, some of the ulama say no. The correct opinion in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best is yes. However, this discussion sometimes might feel a bit futile, because whatever our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said at the end, with regards to religion, we know is the essence of deen. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made him free from sin and free from mistake with regards to religion. So it might feel a bit futile, whether it was ijtihad or whatever, the fact that he said it and it's attributed to him authentically, then there is no dispute regarding the validity of what he said. However, did ijtihad exist amongst the companions? We're talking about fiqh at the time of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when Jibreel alayhi salam would come down with the revelation and the answer to everything that they needed. Was there ijtihad amongst the companions? Yes, the correct answer is yes, there was ijtihad. And the wisdom behind there being ijtihad, for those who ask the question that why was the ijtihad when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was revealing directly, there was no need for anybody to think. The reason why there was ijtihad was to train the ummah for after the death of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this is the impetus of having a vision. When you have a vision, you know what to do, when to do it, and how to do it. It's very important. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was a visionary. He wanted Islam to reach all four corners of the world until the day of Qiyamah. It wasn't a phase where fiqh would exist when he was there and Jibreel was descending and there was no form of succession in terms of looking after the laws of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on earth. So during his time, it was wisdom and hikmah that the sahaba were allowed to practice this concept of ijtihad. And this is clear in the statement of Mu'adh ibn Jabal radiallahu an, when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent him to Yemen, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked him, that what will you do? He says, I will, when circumstances arise, then my reference will be the Quran. He says, what if it's not in the Quran? He said, the Sunnah. He says, what if you don't find it in the Sunnah? He says, I will do ijtihad. I will practice, observe ijtihad based on the Quran and the Sunnah. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam approved that. And we see cases of ijtihad at the time of our beloved Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from the Sahaba radiallahu anhum ajma'een. Like when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent Mu'adh to Yemen, he did ijtihad there. There were certain rulings that he released based on his personal reasoning. And this is also manifest in how, for example, Abdullah ibn Amr performed tayammum on a cold night when he was experiencing spiritual or janaba, when you spiritually unclean. It's not a physical cleanliness or uncleanness, it's a spiritual one, right? Where you need to observe ghusl. So he observed tayammum and observed the salah. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, you're observing the salah whilst you are in a state of janaba, whilst you're in a state of ritual impurity. He says, I remember the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَلَا تَقْتُلُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, and do not kill yourselves. So it was a cold night, and he feared, if I use this water, I will harm myself greatly. He observed ijtihad. He goes, I remember that, thus observed tayammum, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam smiled. That, alhamdulillah, there we go. This is the training that's now starting to flower and come into effect. These are the flag bearers of fiqh after my passing. So fiqh or ijtihad was observed by the companions of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, just like also when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after the Ahzab, when Banu Qurayza, they had a contract with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but what did Banu Qurayza do? They broke that contract and allowed some of the Ahzab or some groups an entry from behind, right, to attack the believers. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made their plot fail. When Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam understood that this is what Banu Qurayza did, he said, no one should read Salatul Asr until you reach Banu Qurayza. So as they went on the journey to Banu Qurayza, what happened? The sun began to set. So a group of them said, let's stop the journey, observe Salah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, inna salata kanat ala al-mu'minina kitaba mawquta. Right? Salah has been placed at a fixed and prescribed time. The sun is setting, the time of Asr is ending. Let's observe Salah. Another group said, no. Today, Salatul Asr is not based on the sun setting. Salatul Asr is based on us reaching Banu Qurayza. Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, do not observe Salatul Asr until you reach. So the first group said, no. What the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam meant by that was that we rush towards Banu Qurayza. You see how it happens when somebody says something and then you understand something? which he probably didn't intend. What we said earlier, how important it is to study with the scholars. So this was ijtihad happening. So some did ijtihad and observed the salah, and some did ijtihad and observed it when they reached Banu Qurayza, and when they produced what happened to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he smiled and said that they were both correct, because obviously they both observed ijtihad. This doesn't mean that the truth is many. The truth is only one. The haqq is only one. The haqq is only one. But they didn't have to repeat their salah because they based their ruling on ijtihad. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as he said, that if a person does ijtihad and he's correct, then Allah gives him two rewards. And if he's wrong, then he gets one reward. Right? So this was fiqh at the time of our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In summary, in this era, rulings were legislated by the Quran. That's number one. Number two, rulings were legislated by the sunnah. Number three, there was also deduction from the Quran and the sunnah. This is a summary of fiqh at the time of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam.